Hey, everybody. Welcome to this week's webinar. People are kind of continuing to file in, so I thought I'd let kind of the early birds in first, and we would get started. Super excited today to bring in Eric Kiker from what was the Digestible Brand, but what we're going to learn has kind of evolved here over the last few months. I've known Eric for, I think, the last year or two, really since I started WeStock, and he's been really great sounding board for as we internally brand ourselves. And then we did a webinar early last year that was received really well. And so kind of wanted to bring him back into the fold. I think branding, messaging, a lot of this stuff is things that get punted really early on. And then you always see these posts on LinkedIn where it's like, we just rebranded, or we just fixed our messaging. And I think the brands don't spend enough time on this early on. And so I'm excited to have Eric kind of in the fold here today to walk us through everything. We'll do Q&A at the end. We had quite a few people RSVP, so I think we're going to have people just kind of filing in throughout. I know it's the middle of the day right before Memorial Day weekend. So I'll let Eric take it from here, and we'll open it up for questions at the end.
Thanks, man. So yeah, I'm Eric Kiker. I am a messaging guy. So I think of, you know, brand, a lot of people use brand and branding to mean different things. For me, it means what is the line in the sand, the stake in the ground, and the truth that you can anchor your brand to that will make the most people who fit your brand and what you're doing just glue to you. So that's what I use language to do that. I've been a writer for 30 some years, and I have a pretty unique process, and I have a very diverse set of clients that I've worked with. I've worked with Naked Juice, Perfect Bar, Lenny and Larry's, a bunch of people in food and a bunch of people outside of food. So this is my little talk called From Digestible to Human. And I have been the Digestible brand for about the last 3 years, and I'm switching it up. I'm going to get rid of that particular name, and I'm moving to something that I think is greater than where I have been, truer to what I have been, and I think a better way to describe it, and it's called Humanbranded. And no, this is not the logo. That's Accenture's logo. But I thought the combination of the greater than symbol with the human branded tucked in there worked pretty well. Darn, this thing. So why would I do that? Why would I go from digestible to human branded? So what is or what was digestible in my mind, digestible brand? It has always been about being differentiated. If you're not differentiated from the people next to you on shelf, or really now anybody in the store, you can't possibly win. Or if you do, it's just a lot of a slog. And I'm going to use that word slog a little bit later. I've always been about emotional. I think that we can, as humans, we get logic all day long, but we still make our buying decisions based on emotion. And so emotion is always an important part, and there are lots of emotions. Fist in the air is something that I have built a mantra around. I always say, if you do nothing else, put a fist in the air on the behalf of your consumer, on the behalf of your consumer. And so what is Digestible Brand not been? It hasn't been about generic or surfacey. I've got an example and an exercise that I'm going to take you guys through in a little bit to show how you can get from sort of like a Me Too kind of a brand purpose to something much, 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 much deeper and in an easy way. So I believe that you got to go deeper. And look at us. I know that a lot of us want to talk and show our customers all the great things that we're doing for them, but we forget to tell them that it's for them sometimes. And we end up saying we too much and you, as in you, the consumer, not nearly enough. So those are the things that Digestible Brand and I have always been. So what are we moving to for human? It's all of those things plus language and messaging that is more vulnerable. And vulnerable is a word we're starting to see some people on LinkedIn, you know, be more honest and vulnerable and talk about, you know, the bad week or the bad day that they had. So I think that if we as business people are starting to do this, at least in the 10,000 people that are connected to me, maybe there's a reason for us to start opening that up to our consumers. I want to move us from we to our, and it's sort of that statement about, oh, look at us on the left-hand side there. We do a lot of talking about we the brand and we the team, and we do a lot of celebrating with each other and all of that. I want to move to our, which is a philosophy around the idea that you share your brand with your consumer. And if you do that, if you really share your brand with them, you will actually help them with something in their lives and they will help you back. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that later. So it's not manipulative, maudlin, or savior. And when we use that word vulnerable, I think it's real easy to sort of like hook these words to that idea. Because when you open yourself up, you're more easily manipulated, and we don't ever want to do that. So that's from digestible to human. And so about that manipulative, maudlin, savior thing, I want to show you an example. I don't know how many of you guys know this show, Ted Lasso. If you don't know it, please know it. It's just so, it's a beautiful, gorgeous, wonderful, funny, touching show. I want to use this clip as an example of how you can be vulnerable without being maudlin or looking like you're trying to be a savior. So just for the people that don't know the show, here's a little recap. A woman divorces her philandering husband and ends up taking over his London-based football or soccer club, which he just dearly loves more than anything. Determined to destroy her ex-husband, whose name is Rupert, and you'll see him in this clip, by destroying his beloved team, Rebecca, the ex-wife, who you'll also see, hires American football coach Ted, aka Wanker. He earns this nickname very quickly because he knows nothing about football in England or soccer to the rest of us in America. But as it turns out, he's a master of human nature, kindness, and the power of forgiveness, all while being funny as hell. So this is about a 4-minute clip, and I just want to show this to you and make some points after.
So Rupert, y'all take your darts over here pretty seriously, huh? What's the billiard game y'all do that sounds like a brand of cookies? Snooker? That's it. That's the one. Yeah, boy, I'd love to curl up on a couch under a weighted blanket, watch You Got Mail, and devour a box of Snookers. See what we got here. Hey, there it is.
Do you like dots, too?
Oh, okay, I'm more of a cornhole man myself. Yeah.
How about a game? I mean, we could maybe wager. Say, 10,000 pounds?
Well, as my doctor told me when I got addicted to fettuccine Alfredo, that's a little rich for my blood. How about this? If you win, I'll let you pick the starting lineup of the last two games of the season. But if I win, you can't go anywhere near the owner's box, at least not while Rebecca's still in charge.
Ted, what the hell are you doing?
Well, I believe some folks call it White Knight, but I don't know. I'm just following my gut here. It's okay. So no one wins. What do you think?
You're wrong.
Okay.
Double in, double out.
Whatever you say, Rupert Deuce. Yeah. Just let me know if I'm winning or losing, all right?
Oh, I forgot I had these on.
Oh, wait a second. I forgot I'm left hand. Oh, it's going to be a hoot.
William Rupert, get in.
Shut your stupid little twat mouth, I'll shut it for you.
Shall I be giving you the lineup card now, Ted? I shall be putting Obasanya back on defence where he belongs.
That's exactly what I said, didn't I?
No, it's not all Ted's fault. My ex-wife's the one who brought the hillbilly to our shores. I know she's always been a bit randy, but I never thought she would fuck over an entire team.
Hey! Better manners when I'm holding a dart. Please.
Need to win. 2 triple 20s and a bullseye.
Good luck.
You know, Rupert, you guys have underestimated me my entire life. And for years, I never understood why. It used to really bother me. But then one day, I was driving my little boy to school, and I saw this quote by Walt Whitman. It was painted on the wall there. It said, "Be curious, not judgmental." I like that. So I get back in my car, and I'm driving to work, and all of a sudden it hits me. all them fellas that used to belittle me, not a single one of them were curious. You know, they thought they had everything all figured out, so they judged everything, and they judged everyone. And I realized that they're underestimating me. Who I was had nothing to do with it. Because if they were curious, they would ask questions. You know, questions like, have you played a lot of darts, Ted? Which I would have answered, yes, sir. Every Sunday afternoon at a sports bar with my father from age 10 till I was 16 when he passed away. Fuck you, Sauce.
So, though I'm curious, like Ted, could your brand be smart, authentic, vulnerable, touching, funny, like a person, like a human? Would letting your brand be more human be a good thing? Now, some of us believe in the universe that comes in and puts things in our path or helps us out when we need it. Other people look at things that happen and ascribe meaning to these coincidences. I'm in a little bit of both of those camps, but while I was working on this deck, this quote came into my inbox from old Seth Godin, or Godin, I don't even know how to pronounce it. And I thought it was really appropriate, so I wanted to share it with you. Up close, face to face, it's difficult to dismiss the humanity of others. It's only when we decide to industrialize the process, to do it all at once, to boil it down to numbers, that's when we begin to disconnect, one at a time, because it might feel like a slog to you, but it matters to them. And I just zoomed in on the part of this that I thought was particularly appropriate for this especially talk, because it might feel like a slog to you, but it matters to them. And I just pushed a couple of words around and changed the meaning to this, because it feels like a slog to them, and it matters to you. If any of y'all know your Greek mythology, you'll recognize this as a well-designed interpretation of Sisyphus. Now, Sisyphus was a Greek god, and he got sideways with Zeus, and he was sentenced to push an enormous boulder uphill all day long, only to watch it roll back down to the bottom, and he had to do that for all eternity. So he had to struggle forever, and I'm wondering, does that look like anybody that you know? Let me see if I can let her in. I got her, Cam. So we're all struggling all the time. I have days sometimes that feel like this. I have hours in the day that feel like this. I can't imagine anybody that doesn't understand this metaphor. So that's what Human Branded is all about. So here's the theory behind Human Branded in outline format. Being human is hard. We can be a pretty miserable bunch. Especially for the last 14 months or so, but even before that, and I'm arguing way after we drop the masks and get back to normal, we could be pretty darn miserable. And we can be very afraid of revealing that fact to people. See perfect Instagram lives, for an example. You look at your social feed and you see your friends, and Bill just got into Yale, and Jonathan just got a big promotion, and Marjorie just made partner. And we're all going to Mallorca together. I mean, it's like nobody ever talks about their struggles in social media. We're all trying so damn hard to make it look like we've got it all together, because we don't believe that, we don't want to be judged. So the cool thing is, brands are in constant contact with humans. Your brand might not be, but collectively, brands are in constant contact with people. Only the news media maybe come into second, but I would argue, I can look around my room right here and I can see 10 brands that I know and some in some cases love. Most brands don't seem to see the slog, that people are going through, or if they do, they deal with it in a surfacey kind of a way. See, guilt-free snack. Now, I've gotten down on guilt-free snack because it's sort of like, well, thanks. How am I supposed to feel the other 23 hours and 55 minutes of the day that I'm not eating your snack? We all feel pretty guilty and pretty bad most of the time. So the question is, can brands do better by helping humans feel better about themselves? We can let people off the hook. We can let people feel less alone. And remember, we don't have to do this in a maudlin or overly touchy-feely way. And just see Ted Lasso for an example of that. That clip I showed you was the most vulnerable, touching, long clip of the entire first season. And it's funny because the trailer for the second season, which starts in July, the big old super that sort of like sums up the whole entire program is kindness makes a comeback. And so this show is about kindness, and it's pretty amazing. So that's the theory behind Human Branded. And just so you know, this is not some altruistic, I'm not starting a nonprofit. This is to help brands help themselves by helping fellow humans. That is my purpose. And for me, the purpose is always the first thing that comes out of your mouth. It's always starts with, we exist too. So at Human Branded, we exist to help brands help themselves make more profit, be more successful, struggle less like old Sisyphus back there by helping fellow humans. So I've got a couple of examples, and then I've got a couple of little exercises that dramatize my process. So example number one is Ted Lasso would say barbecue sauce. This is about redneck lipstick. It's a small brand. It's mostly in the South. It's got about 500 or so Walmarts in about four states. I have just taken an equity position with this brand, and we've been working on it. We're about to relaunch it. So if you go and look at the website or anything, that's all the old stuff. I'm waiting for the patent and trademark office to give me the go-ahead on our selling idea. And once we have that, we're gonna blow the doors off of this thing. But in the interim, this is the founder's story that I wrote for Bobby Wagner. And I'll just read it to you. He's from Arkansas. He talks like this. He's a friendly fella. You really like him automatically because of the way he talks. I'm going to go ahead and talk like me. I'm Bobby Wagner, founder of Redneck Lipstick, and this is my story. I kind of like that it has similar aspects to other founders' stories you might hear. For me, it's encouragement for others and proof that if you have passion and patience, you too can bring something to the world that's, as I say, real good. The recipe was my daddy's. He was true to the name of his hometown, Grubbs, Arkansas, because he loved eating and eating barbecue. And he stirred those loves together to create this sauce. By the time I was 27, I'd finally talked him into giving up the recipe. But during one particular barbecue I threw, my European coworkers wouldn't let me keep it to myself. You should bottle this stuff, they said, in a variety of accents. So I did. I went from my first 20 case order to being placed in 20 stores in a barbershop, to an invitation to Shark Tank, to a single Walmart, to 12 Walmarts, to 45 to 500. A&E brought me on their Rooster and Butch show, and today you can find Redneck Lipstick in more than 1,000 locations. Daddy, your sauce made it big. With thanks and plenty of napkins, Bobby. Now, what makes this Human Branded? Right off the bat, it's vulnerably human. It's not selling, it's storytelling. It can sit at the top of the funnel before anybody gets to know you very well, although it's more like a funnel to me, a vulnerable funnel. It allows telling more of Bobby's story as time goes by. I can introduce people to his family, his neighbors, and his dogs. I can invite us into his kitchen and patio to watch him barbecue. We can introduce recipes and contests. What I didn't tell you in that story was Bobby's daddy is dead. He died in 2020. It wasn't COVID related. I don't know why that matters, but that's what we tend to say about people who died last year. It allows us to connect with people who, like Bobby, have lost their dads. Like, what a great Father's Day promotion it would be to like celebrate Father's Day in this special way for those of us who've lost our fathers. Raise a rib to dad. And we can name a new flavor or line extension after Bobby's dad, on and on and on, based on this tiny little story. So that's what makes that human branded for me. Here's another example. Climate change got you hot under the collar. You want fries with that? This is for a company called Wild Pastures Burger Company. They're opening a restaurant in Boulder, Colorado, and they're going to franchise if they're successful. They've got a couple of other brands, and what the thread that runs through all of them is that they believe that the animals that we use for food need to be humanely raised. They need to have the best lives possible. They need to be on pasture, eating grass, living their lives like they would live them out if we didn't have them pinned up or whatever. They're against factory farming and all of that kind of stuff. They want to see us do better as humans for our animals. And they believe in regenerative agriculture, which, if you don't know about that, is really just putting ruminants, cows and things that eat grass, back on farmland. There was a time that was how we raised food in this country. Food was raised with animals and land together, and then we sort of like split it all off to make it more efficient. What anybody's fault, they were just trying to like feed more people more cheaply. But now they're opening a burger company or a burger restaurant, and this is the story that I wrote for them. Craveable taste, better health, and a solution to climate change. Now that's a combo meal. Get ready to expect a whole lot more from a burger, fries, and shake. Wild Pastures Burger Company, where embracing two little known terms, holistic grazing or regenerative agriculture, changes everything. It's a philosophy that could reverse climate change and one that results in the most delicious, healthiest version of everyone's favorite all-American meal. Let's save our health and our environment. Let's have a Wild Pastures burger and let's save us all. Wild Pastures Burger Company, the cheeseburger that saved the world. Now, it's a serious subject, but what makes it human branded? I think we take a lot of the edge off that we might have put on this if it was a more activistic approach, which it isn't. It acknowledges the elephant in the room, which is most of us believe there's a problem with our climate, but we have trouble imagining a solution. It's all so big. And the news is so dire all the time. There's nothing in here to guilt trip over. We're not blaming anybody for what happened. We're not picking sides either. We have firm beliefs about our perspective, but we're going to be civil. We're not going to argue with people that don't agree the way we or don't feel the way we feel. And we're making a potential solution simple. The belief is get back to putting ruminants on farmland and rely on nature and history. So that's what makes that particular example human branded. Now let's get into something that applies to you. You want to make your brand more human branded all by yourself? Ask, why is the sky blue like a three-year-old? If any of y'all have ever had a kid, you know that game they play where they just keep asking you why. So I started with a fairly generic, fairly, you know, we in food, we see a lot of these types of sort of founder statements. I couldn't find healthy snacks my kids would eat, so I created them. Now that feels generic to me. It may be true, but I don't think it's very deep and I don't think it's human branded. So I just started asking why. So I couldn't find healthy snacks my kids would eat, so I created them. Why? Because I want my kids to eat well. All right, that makes sense. Why? Because I want them to grow up healthy. All right, that makes a good sense too. Why? Because it's my responsibility as a mother. All right, now we're starting to get in a little bit deeper territory. Why do you feel that way? Because I want to do what my mother couldn't. Okay, we've just gotten significantly deeper. Why? Because snacks like these didn't exist when she had to feed us. And that's right. She had to sort of like do everything and make everything up as she went along. So where I ended up was this line. I'm making healthy snacks kids love, so moms have what our moms didn't. Now for me, that is significantly deeper from where we started. It takes the focus of the story and completely changes it. In the beginning, we were laying it all on the kids. They're finicky and I need to help them. That doesn't seem very human branded to me. That seems a little blamey. Then we took it to making it about mom's desire to do better. You remember that line about halfway down the page about, well, it's my responsibility to do this. They can't do it on their own. That feels better for me. And then we took it all the way to making it an homage to all moms, present and past. Now, all of a sudden, you've got a big brand and you've got something that you can, you've got some heartstrings you can pull on in a funny way if you want, or a touching way if you want, or a combination. Just look at all the things this lets the brand talk about. This I just wrote down, like, you've got to do content. You've got to do content for SEO. You've got to rank on Google. You got to bring people to your site. You got to do social. You got to do ads. What are you going to talk about? Most of the time, a lot of us talk about the 20% off coupon code, or we show how amazingly delicious this snack or this meal or whatever looks. What if we could talk about some of this stuff? Moms now, moms then. Favorite stories of our moms. Snacks and meals, now and then. How is nutrition better now? How is it worse? Pages from your mom's recipe book. Diary of a Kid, now versus then. Every generation of moms. How were they alike and different? How will our kids feed their kids? The future of snacking. Nutritional tidbits and wisdom through all mom time. And again, I did this entire exercise in less than 15 minutes. Granted, I do it all the time, so I'm a little bit more practiced at it. But think if you could spend a half a day on this, working on your whys to really get to a deeper purpose for your brand, and then figuring out what the heck. Test it by seeing how many things you could write about. Now, here's another way to get human branded on your own. I'm going to take you through a structure, and then I'm going to apply it to an example from a recent client of mine. So don't worry if this seems a little esoteric in the beginning. I call this We They Hour, where we is the company, they is the consumer, an hour is the combination. Remember in the beginning how I said I wanted to move from we to our? This is exactly what this is. From being very centered on what you're doing and your team to sharing this brand with your consumers by finding common ground. So first we look at we and we ask, what are the deep fears, frustrations, and hopes that we have around, and I just pulled a couple of examples from my mom's snack example up above. So fears, frustrations, and hopes around talking to moms and making snacks. Now you could make this list longer, but you could see how you could say, we have fears about talking to moms. What are some of those? Well, are we gonna be able to get on the same wavelength with her? Is she gonna believe us? Is she gonna feel like she's got common ground with us, et cetera? What are some of our hopes about making snacks? Well, we hope we can taste and feel and be healthier than others that are like us. We hope others don't come in and copy us. We hope people believe that we're really doing a good thing for them, and we hope that we really are. So then we talk about the consumer. They have deep fears, frustrations, and hopes about, now their subjects are a little bit different, being moms and feeding their kids. So what are some of the frustrations that moms have with being moms? It's really busy. I'm always going. I hate it when they spit something out that I know is good for them. It's frustrating to me to try to teach them how to eat healthy. What are their hopes when it comes to feeding their kids? I hope that they will grow up to be healthy humans and that they will know how to feed their kids, etc. And then we look at an hour really should be things that either one of us can say that makes sense to each of us based on our need. So our deep fears, frustrations, and hopes about, and I just picked this out of thin air, doing the right thing. So doing the right thing, what are our fears about that or our frustrations about that? It's hard sometimes to do the right thing. We want to make sure that we are, though. We want to make sure other people don't think that we're not doing the right thing. We want to make sure that other people believe that we are. So there's a little bit of a structure here that you could make lists on your own, pick a moderator, fill the wall up with pages and do this. And then we come down to sort of like the collective of all the work we just did. We bring we, they, and our together by asking two key questions. Collectively, our greatest pain is, what are we worried about the most? I'm reading a book that you should read too called The Persuasion Code. It's all about neuromarketing. And basically they've got a lot of research that says the parts of our brains that make buying decisions are more interested in escaping pain than they are to going after pleasure. Think about every infomercial you've ever seen. What do they start with? They always start with, are you tired of the hassle of blank? And then they go to the solution. So collectively, our greatest pain is, and collectively, we alleviate that pain by doing what? So this is my structure. This is my new structure. I'm going to show you an example. This is for a brand called Adapt 180. I did the, I named it as well as created all the work for it. And this is the We They Our example. A little bit about the brand. They are a functional medicine and ancestral health-based brand. Functional medicine, I've got a functional medicine doctor. He got his MD and practiced for a long time. And then he went and he got extra schooling to really understand on a deep, deep level how the entire human system works. And ancestral health is really all about like what we as a people used to do before modern medicine to take care of ourselves. We used to be much more preventative than we are now. Not anybody's fault, and I'll show you why. They take that idea and that philosophy and they use it to train health coaches who then deliver their coaching to consumers, to ordinary people, through a telemedicine kind of a model. So you pay one price and you can see a doctor, you can see a nutritionist, you can see a psychologist if you want to, and it's all one price and you do it all, you do it month after month. So the we have deep fears, frustrations, and hopes around. And for this, these guys, it was the current state of people's health and the medical system's inability to improve it. So we said, let's make a list. What are these fears and frustrations? Modern medicine grew out of emergency treatment, not prevention. I mean, when you realize that an infection used to kill people, it's not hard to see how we've really sort of gotten into a triage kind of a thing where you don't go to the doctor unless something's wrong, and then you go to the doctor and he or she prescribes a medicine or a treatment or an operation to fix you. These guys want to work, you know, more about prevention. So our physicians don't really understand the whole human system. They specialize. They're unaware, the physicians, of the mismatch between biological programming and our modern world. We still have the same basic genetics that we did back when we had to run from tigers. But our world has changed dramatically where those threats don't exist anymore. And that causes some problems. So really only about 6% of Americans follow the basic rules for a healthy lifestyle. Eat right, get exercise, get plenty of sleep, try to avoid stress, don't smoke or do heroin. So our customers, they have deep fears, frustrations, and hopes around what? Their health, what to do about it, and why it all seems impossible. I mean, do you really think that anybody doesn't know that they ought to be healthy and doesn't know the basic things they ought to do to be healthy? But we get real confused, and here's some of the reasons why. We get conflicting information from medical professionals in the news media. That leads to a mistrust of health professionals and an unwillingness to go in to be seen because they're all going to tell you something wrong. We get bombarded with diets and exercise programs that never seem to work. We continuously fail to make any meaningful progress. And here's the big one. We blame it all on ourselves. We call ourselves fat and lazy and stupid and ignorant and all these things that we say sometimes as a joke, but we're really blaming ourselves. And the fact of the matter is it's not our fault. So we go to the collective, our deep fears, frustrations, and hopes about wanting to know and tell the truth and have and deliver a solution. So for us on the Adapt 180, it's wanting to tell the truth. And for the consumer, it's wanting to know and have a solution, and we want to deliver the solution. So some of the items that we put on this list were, we want to expose the fact that our survival-based programming is still very much in charge. We need to let people in on their very normal drives to conserve energy and eat calorie-rich foods. No wonder you don't diet or exercise. Your biological programming is telling you to do these things. We want to replace the judgment with strategies for working around our programming. And finally, we want to achieve and maintain optimal health. And so really what Adapt 180 is doing is letting people off the hook. So the We They Our then collectively, our greatest pain together is how hard it is to be healthy. And then collectively, we alleviate that pain, starting by letting ourselves and others off the hook. So here's the purpose that I wrote for them. We exist to show millions of people why health is hard, why it's not their fault, and how to fix it, leading to rich, fulfilling lives for all. The story: we know why health is hard, we know it's not your fault, and we know how to fix it. Eat right, exercise, good advice that ignores evolution. Fact is, we're so similar genetically to our hunter-gatherer ancestors. And while we know eating convenient high-calorie food while surfing the couch is unhealthy, it's an ideal survival strategy to our genes. That's why healthy is so hard. Adapt 180 helps your ancient programming work with the modern world to dramatically improve health and reverse chronic disease. It's proof. To write a healthier future, we need to start in the past. Adapt 180, the future of health is history. So that's an example of the structure. You might say, well, heck, they've got an awfully big, complicated brand. How do we do this sort of thing with a cracker or a chip? And I already showed you that in the why example. A mom who wants to make healthy things for kids because she couldn't find it, all of a sudden could be about moms everywhere, past and present. It's a big emotional idea that just allows you to talk more about what you've got. So remember this fella, Sisyphus. Let him or her be a reminder to you that while every one of you on this call makes something different, you can all make the same thing. You can all make empathy. And for me, empathy goes in both directions. And that's what makes this a beautiful theory for me, is that you're going to help people and they're going to help you. You have struggles too. Most people that you meet at a cocktail party and you say, and they ask you what you do, and you say, I own a food brand, they automatically think that you're a millionaire, that you're riding around in a Lamborghini, that you're on the beach all the time, that you've got it made. They have no idea the struggles that you go through, that anybody who owns a business goes through. And I believe that you can, while helping them get off the hook and feel better about themselves, I believe that you can tell them a little bit about you too. Let them in on it. Let them see how hard it is while showing them how you help them. And they will say things like this: you want moms to have what our moms didn't? So do we. That's empathy in both directions. You want to let people off the hook so they can be healthier? We want that too. That's your consumer saying this to you. Suddenly that engagement that we all want in social media comes more naturally. It isn't forced, and you're not frustrated because you're sharing. You have now shared your brand with your consumer. And so this is the last thing that they say, no matter what your brand is: you want what we want, and we want to help you help us get that. People that love brands, and there are brands that you can name that are loved, people are on their side. Whenever anything bad happens to Apple, I feel bad because I love Apple. And it's not just because of the thing I hold in my hand. It's because of what they have done and how they have changed my life. I started off with a PC and I got to a Macintosh. I was, I'm dating myself, but my life was changed by that brand. And I believe it doesn't have to be a computer. It can be a snack or a food or a shake or a whatever personal care item. I believe it can be done. I do it all the time. So that's Human Branded for me. And I'm going to be Eric at thedigestiblebrand.com for the next little while. We got 18 minutes, Cam.
Yeah, no, Eric, that was awesome. I appreciate it. I know you're polishing up kind of the Human Branded, but that was definitely very polished. And I think you got all your points across, so I appreciate it. If anyone has any questions, you can unmute yourself. You can throw it in the chat. You can kind of feel free to chime in here. I know we have a lot of brand owners here. So any specific questions to your brand too, or any examples, like, we're happy to walk through that. But just kind of wanted to give the last few minutes here to any questions. So Feel free, we'll give it the next minute or two and see if anybody pops up, but I don't know if anyone has any questions right now.
Look at all these people.
Feel free to unmute yourself though and just ask away. Oh no, it's a shy bird.
Hey.
How's it going?
You guys hear me?
Yeah,
my name's Brian. I'm with a brand called Boozy. And we started off about 4 years ago. And what you're preaching right now is kind of how we started. Boozy is not just a product, it's a lifestyle about how we can help you make your life better, how it cleans up your drinks and gets rid of the contaminants in it. And that's how we've kind of preached it, but we've, I think, been scattered. This is really going to help me focus a lot and rewrite some of our information. I really want to say thank you.
Cool, man. You're welcome. I appreciate it. And I'm glad that you're sort of on to that idea. You know what I mean? I think brands are we like to tell our consumers things like, you know, we're for a healthy lifestyle for you. And I think what we can do is say, and this is just going to, I'm just going to repeat myself, is, but show the opposite. You are a healthy lifestyle for us.
Yeah.
We cannot live without you. And I don't think we tell people that enough. And that's just one little part of it, right? If you have a big enough why or a big enough purpose, you can really talk to people about such a larger universe and feel more like a person as opposed to a brand. Let me see what, is it Harony? We versus you. Simon Sinek has a different POV. He says, if you say who you are, then people who believe what you do will join you. How do you see that as different than what I'm talking about?
I think you kind of clarified it as you went on with the we versus you versus the combined. I think it kind of leans towards how you can solve that. But when you started out, you talked about how we don't talk about the consumer enough and we're usually talking just about ourselves. So that's when I asked my question.
Okay, well, the we is internal. That's a way of sort of understanding the internal team.
Mm-hmm.
Because for me, before you can really understand who you're dealing with, who your they is, you really need to understand yourselves. And I believe it all comes from the founder. I agree with everything that Simon says. I think that his work is brilliant, and I'm trying to take it in my own particular direction.
Yep.
By adding this idea that life is hard, and that is the biggest. If I could leave you with nothing else, it's the idea of understand that there isn't anybody that's just skating through this existence. I don't care how much money you've got or how good looking you are or anything. We all have problems. And the biggest part of that is we can't feel okay about letting those things out into the world. You as a brand can give people permission to do that and then solve some issues and make real, real friends.
Yeah. No, thank you. Thanks
you bet.
Again.
I hope that helped.
Yes.
So we did have another question in the chat. This one comes from Michael. Hey, Michael, nice to have you here. What happens if you keep asking why and we landed a personal motivator rather than a customer motivator?
I don't know, Michael. I'd be happy to help take you through it and see. I think that it's a great exercise to try with your team. I mean, you can really seriously do it in probably an hour. And just see what happens. If you end up with a personal motivator, I don't see how that can't apply to the consumer. Because whatever you did, whyever you did this, and especially for the founder, he or she was thinking about their own personal pain when they invented this thing. And that pain has got to be shared, otherwise you're your only customer. Does that make any sense?
Eric,
yeah,
thank you,
that's... Yeah, no, thank you. That's very helpful.
Cool. And thanks for not doing heroin, too. You left me a little chat there.
So Eric, I know you run a bunch of like workshops and you work with a ton of individual brands. How many times do you hear brands say, I'm the only brand that does this, or we're the only company that does this? And they tend to then hang their hat on that versus kind of digging deeper into it. Cause we hear it all the time, like on demos. And every time I have a conversation with a new brand, it's the first thing they always say. It's like, we're the first brand that does that. It's like, I just had a call literally 30 minutes ago from a brand that does the same thing, you know? And it's very hard. And I know the buyer's hearing that. And so if the customer's hearing that too, I think it's very tough for that customer to have a genuine connection with that brand.
Well, I hear it all the time. And again, this is me trying to be human branded for those brands that say that. I believe that they believe that. And I also believe that they are right, that they probably are the only brand that does something that may to the rest of the world be a shade of gray. You know what I mean? If we're the only brand that uses navy beans instead of pinto beans, I mean, that we are the only brand that uses navy beans. But then if we do the why exercise, maybe we get down to something that's much less about the function or the individual ingredient. As a consumer, I don't know that I care about an ingredient unless it's an ingredient that I've never, ever seen before. And then you've got a little bit of a window. I mean, I've got some friends and they've grown this brand. They call it Overtone. It's CPG because it's personal care. They liked coloring their hair, but they hated what they had to go through, going to the salon, all the damage, everything. So they made a conditioner that has color in it. And you wash it in at home and it lasts for a while. And so they actually said, we couldn't find a conditioner with coloring, so we invented it. Now, there really wasn't anything like that. And so if you really, really have come up with something like one of a kind, you've never seen it before, and you can put up the barriers to entry that'll keep other people from doing it, great. But for me, it's like, man, I got to get down to what I'm trying to do is take the functional and bring it down to an emotional. When I did Naked Juice, they were not anywhere near where they are now. They were just in SoCal. They wanted to sit next to Odwalla in every market in America. Odwalla added sugar and or preservatives to half of their SKUs. Naked did neither of those things. The tagline that I wrote for them at the time was Naked, nothing to hide. It led with the functional, but it got emotional immediately because now you can talk to consumers. This was before social media, this was 12 years ago. But now I could talk to consumers about let your health show, you know, expose your healthy side. Talk to me about what you don't have to hide. And think about our world now with the divides that we have, or let's just say the passionate viewpoints that everybody seems to have. You'd have a lot of, you know, you'd get a lot of dialogue going. Who else has a question?
I think Dina has a question. If you want to go, Dina, hi, you can unmute yourself.
Hi.
Hey.
I don't know how to get rid of the hand.
I just did it for you.
Okay. All right. Okay. So I have a product that I sell at farmers markets, and I've been doing it at this one particular farmers market for 7 years. Wow. And so I have access to customers that purchase on a regular basis. My questions, I would like to start asking them this why. Why do they, and those are the questions. What are the questions? I want to ask them why they keep coming back to, well, I mean, I kind of know why they keep coming back to my product versus what's out there,
yeah.
But what it does for them. For example, I make spice roasted pumpkin seeds, various flavors.
Yeah.
Michelle started it because yes, I have nut allergies. I wanted to bring a gift to a friend. And I made
name of the brand.
The brand name, I actually just got the trademark for the Great Pumpkin Seeds.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. And my company is Keystone Cravings.
Okay.
And so I've got repeat customers that often say that they eat it right out of the bag.
Yeah.
Because I ask them, do you put this in yogurt? Because I always make suggestions for use with customers when I'm selling to them. And various flavors go with various types of pairing.
Okay.
And so a lot of times though, surprisingly to me, people will just say, no, I eat it right out of the bag. Eat it right out of the bag.
So I would say why and get them to answer the question. Play the game with them, Dina. What I believe is that we have this, it's very natural to put this wall between us and our consumers. We want to be professional. We want to seem like we're all buttoned up. But most of us are small brands. I mean, I worked on Perfect Bar when they were $1.5 million brand. and I've known Bill Keith and his brothers and sisters for all these years. And they're, I don't know how big of a brand they are right now, but they're bigger than $1.5 million. And they still act like a family, like there's no wall. And that's why I think they've done so well. So heck, why wouldn't you make an Instagram post, or why wouldn't you ask your people at the farmer's market, hey, would you mind going through this little exercise with me on Instagram, and let them do it and give them a bag, you know, give them a break or give them a free bag or whatever, make up little sample bags that you could say, hey man, this is yours just for playing. Because I'm trying to get to a deeper meaning for me. And I know that if I do that, I'll get to a deeper meaning for you, right? Mm-hmm. And get away from the act of putting your hand in a bag. I guarantee you there's something more than that.
Yeah.
Right? Like, just like my mom example, you wouldn't have thought that that person who said, I can't find healthy snacks, my kids will eat, so I'm creating them. And you get down in 5 minutes to a thing that is so much bigger.
Yeah, that's the thing that I need to formulate those questions for them, those whys,
all you have to do is say why. That's the easiest why, in the world.
And why is that important to you to be able to eat them out of the bag? You know, like something like that.
Why? Eat them out of the bag. And they'll say, well, because they're delicious and they don't need anything else. Why? Because, they'll sit there and think, you know, for me, it's just instantaneous. But like I say, I do this for a living.
Yeah. And some people, they'll be driving or they're watching TV or they're at work. Those are the top three answers that I've had so far from them in terms of they just enjoy it instead of sitting and eating cookies or popcorn or something. They're eating this.
You might get down to here's my 2 second guess at what the end might be, because life's complicated enough. Mm. So, I mean, and then you get to talk about things like, hey, what do you like? What are your cheats for making things simpler? You become like the simple pumpkin seeds lady, or you know what I mean? It might go even deeper than that, where it's not just about the product, because there are lots of people that could say, well, I eat nuts out of the bowl, or I eat, you know, raisins out of the thing. And you want to try to get to something that's unique for you.
Yeah.
But play the game, and don't play it with yourself, play it with your family, play it with your friends, and you just, get out some.
And mostly for the most part is to do that with those people that purchase regularly that tend to be that type of eater.
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, do it internally with your own family and friends, and then go to the farmer's market and say, hey, I'm thinking about saying this. How does that ring to you?
Okay.
Get a group of friends together, get your favorite adult lubricant, not heroin. But get some alcohol or some weed or whatever you like, and just like brainstorm. That's all you got to do. And I've given you a structure to do that.
Yeah. Okay. I appreciate that. Thank you. Well,
of course. You're welcome. Who else?
Yeah. About 4 minutes here. So I probably have room for one more question. If there's anybody else who has a question, if you want to unmute yourself or raise your hand, let me know.
Or we can just stare at each other. I can look at all these.
That works too.
Black screens with mics that are muted.
I feel like I'm going to do like a going once, going twice.
That's all right. You guys can
always hit
my email if you want, eric@thedigestiblebrand.com for now.
And we'll record this and throw it up on the WeStock YouTube channel so everybody can go back to it if you want to rewatch it and walk through kind of the experiment on your end. But again, like if you're especially early on in those stages, like just take the time, take the steps, run through what you can. That kind of Eric has provided here. And Eric, thanks so much for the actionable steps. Hopefully people run through this with their own brands. And I look forward to seeing you hopefully in person at a trade show soon.
Oh yeah, man. Wouldn't that be awesome? And you guys let me know. I mean, I do this for brands and on a one-to-one basis, it's pretty expensive. So I'm thinking about taking some of this thinking and turning it into a course, something that I could, you know, sell multiple times. And so drop me a note and let me know if that's a good idea to you. Thanks, Paul. Thanks, Michael. I'm glad you guys appreciated it. David, I think, is gone, but he liked the redneck lipstick story.
And everybody connect with Eric on LinkedIn. He posts a lot of good stuff there too.
Yeah. And if you liked it today, go on there and tag me and let people know. It helps me and it helps everybody.
Awesome.